attendance. Earlier we had an executive session, and there are no items that need to be voted on following executive session. First item, approve various boards and commissions. First, the Accommodation Tax Advisory Committee. We have a file of Derek Norris. A little more motion on Derek Norris.
I'd like to waive the rules and nominate and elect Derek Norris.
Have a motion, second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes. Alcohol and Drug Abuse Commission, we have a spot that is open. No district here related. Debbie? Appalachian Council of Government, we have Chet Morris Jr., and we have a bio of Thomas R. Foster.
I've been asked to maybe hold this over until next month.
Okay. Board of Assessment Appeals. This school district three representative that has resigned, so we need to fill that.
And it needs to be financing of real estate.
And it has to be in the financing of real estate. Building Code Board of Appeals. Paul's in his bio in?
Yes.
Okay. All right. We have downtown airport advisory. Dean Garrison has received employment.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to waive the rules and ask unanimous consent to reappoint Dean Garrison.
Okay, have a motion. Mr. Garrison.
Second.
Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative, and it passes. Employee agreements. We have Julie Thomas from the assessor's office that resigned. Need to fill that position. And Hobbiesville.
Still no word from Hobbiesville on a reappointment or replacing this person.
And then FEMA Communications. We need to fill a spot there. That completes boards of appointments. I would like to take just a moment. He cannot be here later in the day, so he came early. And Henry Giles, if you would, please stand up, sir.
Yes.
Henry recently had a son's fiance who graduated from USC upstate, and I was in the audience, and I think they graduated 830 people here last May, but on the stage was an individual, and he is an honorary doctorate now at the University of South Carolina. Mr. Henry Giles was awarded honorary doctorate from the University of South Carolina. So Henry. We've enjoyed working with you through the years, and we appreciate everything, the role that the community college plays in our community, and especially with educating our citizens and also in economic development. And we think this is a great honor for a great person, and we appreciate your leadership at Spartanburg Community College, and I thank you for all you do, and just congratulate you, Henry.
Thank you.
Thank you, Henry. Henry's got to go to a budget meeting, so I wanted to recognize him at 5:30, but we got him in a little early, so anyway, congratulations.
Since I'm standing, do I have an opportunity?
You do.
First of all, thank you for the honor and recognition. I am truly humbled by what's happened to me recently. With the recognition of something I don't think I deserve. I thought about I really should take that little piece of paper and divide it up in shreds and give it to people in this organization, because I look at SC Works as part of why I get recognition, get recognized, I think, for the things that are going on. I look at Carter Smith and Economic Futures Group and what they do in our partnership with them. I look at y'all and think, I need to be giving all of y'all parts of that, because that's really why I feel like I've been recognized, is because this community is a great community. people work together to try to improve the lives of everyone. And that's what I've enjoyed doing, and I think that's why I'm getting recognized right now. And I'll tell you the other thing, I'm not leaving. I was at an event yesterday in Wofford, because you didn't mention it, and I can be still fine. This is, I received an honorary doctorate degree yesterday at Wofford College.
I didn't know that.
Wow, two doctorate degrees.
Well, but the scary part about it, knowing that I was coming here, I thought, do all these people know something that I don't? Is there something about to happen to me that I don't know? And all of a sudden, Mr. Johnson's put on the executive session for our commission meeting today, an executive session for personnel issues. I'm thinking, are y'all got ready just to push me out through the golden gate? But truthfully, it's been a wonderful experience for me, and I can only take the gratitude on the basis and the recognition on the basis that our college wants to be an integral part of this community, and you are allowing us to do that. So thank you all so much.
Thank you. Thank you. We had Henry here, and we're going to recognize him later on, but he does have a budget meeting today, so I wanted to take time to. Item four, are we carrying that over tonight, Catherine?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I move that the ordinance be postponed indefinitely.
Have a motion.
I'll say second.
Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative, and it passes. Next, we have item five, receive information, take desired action in reference to the 2016 presidential primary, preference primary. Mr. Henry Lake here to present. How you doing, Mr. Lake?
Hi, Mr. Chairman. How are you today? Council members, good evening. And David's going to fire me up here. We have been working for several months focused on the 2016 presidential election cycle. And while we still have some elections to get through in June, we have a June 2nd election for the city of Wofford, a June 9th for Duncan, and then we get into school trustees in November. Our focus has really turned to the 2016 presidential cycle. And what I'd like to do is just brief you on this, on what we're planning to do. The authority to hold the South Carolina presidential preference primaries, which is part of some of the first in the nation, was set aside in the South Carolina Code of Law with references you see there. It basically states that the state committee of the party shall set the date and the hours that the polls will be open. Now, each of you do have a hard copy of this presentation, should you care to look at it later. The anticipated dates are two consecutive Saturdays in February. Currently, it's the Republican primary set for Saturday, February the 20th, the Democratic presidential preference primary for Saturday, February the 27th. That will not take place if Mrs. Clinton is unopposed. Now, to conduct that presidential preference primary, the South Carolina Code of Laws allows the State Election Commission and the authorities responsible for conducting the election to provide for cost-effective measures in conducting these presidential preference primaries, including but not limited to combining polling places while ensuring that the voters have adequate notice and access to the polling locations. Just to show you some of the history and how crowded these presidential preference primaries were, in 2008, there were eight Democratic candidates and 11 Republican candidates. In 2012, since President Obama was unopposed on the Democratic primary, that was not held. And again, we had eight or nine Republican candidates in the 2012 presidential preference primary. Here's what our county participation looked like in these presidential preference primaries from our records. The total turnout for both parties in our county was about 53,000 voters, or about 33% of the registered voters. The Democratic turnout was about 15%, and the Republican turnout was about 18%, compared to the state turnout of 23% for the Democrats and 19.5% for the Republican Party. In 2012, there were about 25% of the Republican registered voters that turned out to vote against a 21% statewide turnout for that. basically disappointing turnouts for determining the leadership of our nation. There are reasons to combine precincts. And without going into some of the challenges that that gives our voter registration board staff, we'll just simply tell you that we're going to get it done. And the criteria we use to combine some of these precincts were the voter history and the proximity to another voting location. There will be 56 standalone precincts. In other words, those precincts are not being combined with any other, and that would include the in-person absentee precinct. Generally takes place in conference room 6 downstairs. There will be 39 combined precincts for those elections. This is a list of the standalone precincts to give you a moment to just look at them. Some of them were done based on very nice voter turnout. Some of them are standing alone because of distance that voters would have to travel if we combined them. For example, Ennery and Cross Anchor. You wouldn't want to combine those because it's a fairly significant difference. Mileage to do. But those would be the 55 standalone precincts. The combined precincts, the list on the left is a precinct that would be voting at the precinct on the right. For example, Arcadia Elementary would be voting at the Jesse Bobo Elementary precinct, and so forth and so on down the line. Now, how did we come to this? I will tell you that we will be making sure that we get the proper notice to the voters. We've made this presentation to the county legislative delegation. We're making it now to you. We'll be certainly to make sure the media is aware of it. We're prepared to make presentations to both political parties in the county and any other group that wants to hear this presentation, such as the League of Women Voters, NAACP, any other group, whether it's a church group, civic group, we'll certainly be prepared to make that presentation. We'll be placing signage at all locations that will be voting elsewhere. We'll be putting this information on the county website. But in spite of all the efforts to educate the public on where to vote, we're still probably going to have some folks who won't be happy with the combinations. But we'll try to enlist them into helping us with the voting process, and maybe they'll understand the challenges involved. Primary of the presentation itself, I'm going to go and change to the Excel spreadsheets to show you some of the data on it. Debbie, you said I'm in here for Excel. These are the standalone precincts, and for example, if you'll notice, let me put too many things up here. Let me reduce this just a little bit. I know it's small, and I'm going to move it a little bit more. In 2008, for example, if you look at the second item, Friendship Baptist Church, you will see that out of the 3,100 voters, in the 2008 presidential preference primary, we had 113 Democratic voters show up, 576 Republican voters. Then kick over to the 2012 presidential preference primary, there were 802 Republican voters. So this is the listing of how we decided which precinct to let stand alone. And we can scroll all the way down to that list, bottom of that list if we needed to. But you certainly have that. Now, here are the ones that will be combined. For example, if you look here at Arcadia Elementary, and folks, I know it's a little tiny letters for you, but Arcadia Elementary, out of about 900 registered voters active, in 2008, they had 95 people show up to vote Democratic and 84 show up to vote Republican. And then in 2012, you had 104 Republican voters show up. So then they'll combine in with the Woodruff Leisure Center and see that. So that's some of the criteria that we did for that. So we went all the way through this to determine what seemed to make sense, both in proximity and voter turnout. So this is why we're going to be combining some of these precincts. Primarily, we have basically 7 days to turn around the voting machines. It is primarily one voting machine at each of the precincts that has to be reset. And that's the one that is used for the visually impaired voters. We only have one of those per precinct. So we have to get out, recalibrate, make sure we've got the right data card in it, and then the other machines are already there. So that's really what we're planning to do. We've had a very much involvement from our Board of Voter Registration Elections. The staff that I have has been absolutely wonderful to do that, and we're going to make every effort to make this thing go off smoothly, and that we will continue to serve the voters in our county. That concludes the presentation that I have. I'm sorry to take any questions if you have any.
Any questions for Mr. Lake? Mr. Lake?
Yes, sir.
Does the state reimburse us for the primary?
The state will reimburse us for the poll managers, cost of the ballots. That's pretty much it, Mr. Chairman. We get left out on some of the other expenses, mileage, overtime, so forth and so on. So a lot of our elections are not fully funded, but that's the reality of the situation, just like our county's not fully funded with the monies they're supposed to turn to us anyhow.
Any other questions, Mr. Lake? All right, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Next, we will go to our committee meetings. First committee is Economic Recruitment and Development. Honorable Daniel Britt, Chairman, Michael Brown, Roger Nutt, members. Mr. Britt?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have several items before us today. And before we get started on this, I did want to recognize Brian Dash and Carter Smith, that Economic Future Group. We had a great celebration Friday a week ago with the Elko, and it's one of the nicest groundbreakings I've ever attended. And the first time I've ever worn white gloves. So, it was fun. But anyhow, thank you for the good work that you do, as well as this council. I mean, this council deserves a lot of credit, as Henry mentioned earlier. Henry Giles and Carter and Brian have both said it. We have a great partnership between our administration, led by Catherine, and our chairman, and the council. We wouldn't be having these successes without the citizens to support us. So a big thanks to all y'all. We have six items, I think, before us today. First is a request for first reading to an ordinance authorizing the execution delivery of a fee agreement between Spartanburg County and Rite Aid of Georgia, Inc. and Flatwood Farms 1 LLC for the application of the infrastructure credit to fee in lieu of tax payments. Do I hear a motion to be approved on first reading?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
I'll second it. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. We'll recommend it to full council at 5:30. Second item is a request for the adoption of a resolution authorizing the execution and delivery of an inducement agreement by and between Spartanburg County and Bahrain, Inc. Do I hear a motion to approve this resolution?
So moved.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. We'll recommend it to full council again at 5:30. Next item also relates to Bahrain. Do I hear a motion that we approve on first reading?
So moved.
Ordinance. Motion is made and second.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Recommend that before council. The next item relates to kickoff. We need a motion to adopt a resolution authorizing under certain conditions the execution and delivery by Spartanburg County, South Carolina, of a fee in lieu of tax agreement for project kickoff with respect to an industrial project in the county whereby the project would be subject to a payment of certain fees of taxes, whereby project kickoff will be provided certain credits against fee payments and reimbursement of investment in related qualified infrastructure. Here, motion that we approve of resolution. Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Recommended from council. Next item also relates to project kickoff. You will hear a meeting, a motion to approve on first reading to an ordinance the execution and delivery of PHILO project kickoff.
So moved.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Recommended for council. The last item, we need a motion to approve on first reading to amend the agreement for development of a joint county industrial business park dated as of June 25th, 2001, by and between Spartanburg County and Cherokee County, South Carolina. Other matters related thereto.
So moved.
Motion moved. Approve on first reading. Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. We recommend the full council at 5:30. Mr. Chairman, that concludes our committee meeting.
Okay, Mr. Britt. Mr. Brown's still in court. He's supposed to be here around 4 o'clock, correct?
Yes.
Our line is under public health today. Personnel and Finance, Honorable Bob Walker, Chairman, Jeff Horton, Jane Hall, members. Mr. Walker.
Mr. Chairman, first of all, we want to receive information and take the desired action in reference to the Accommodation Tax Advisory Committee recommendation for fiscal year 2016. Mr. Bill Clayridge.
I presume that you all have the recommendations out of the committee to be made. And I will not go down those. I would mention we had three no-shows at the presentation, and therefore those we did not, as a committee, agree to recommend anything to those, but the rest of them are as you see them. But we'd be happy to answer any questions you got about.
Anybody have any questions?
I have a lot of questions. I always do every year. I'm a little concerned. I've heard from two individuals who had submitted a request and either did not get their notification to actually come and present in a timely manner. As a matter of fact, we have the Shriners representatives here. Joe Sessions, as well as Team Spartanburg, is here. That usually does that. We also have Stone Soup representative here that does that. I think there is extenuating circumstances in their situation. Actually, what I'd like to do at this time, Mr. Chairman, is move that we hold this off until our next meeting.
We have a motion.
I'll second.
Got a second. All those in favor say aye. Opposed, like sign.
Well, thank you. Yeah, and may I ask a question? Would you like us to do anything?
We'll have Ms. O'Neill to get back to you, and we'll give you some instructions to start. We'll talk about, not necessarily instructions, share with you as to what we'd like to do. So that'd be okay with you?
Sure.
I think there's just some questions as to, you know, if someone files an application but they don't show up for the presentation, you know, where do we stand with that?
Yeah, the history has been, and it's happened before, is that we assumed that they were either not committed to the application or withdrawn or whatever, and that's why we recommend it.
But you assume, do you have anything written in your bylaws that states?
Okay.
Yeah, we'll give it to you, all right?
Sure.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it very much. Second item is receive information, take the desired action in reference to restructuring of staff in the auditor's office and the Honorable Sharon West. Bill Corbett.
Thank you, Bob.
Ms. West.
Thank you, Council. Jeff, I think you may be fishing some. On April 23rd, I sent several personnel action forms along with a detailed letter to Human Resources explaining some restructuring plans I had for my office staff. I was subsequently advised that I needed to get council approval to do this. So I sent you a copy of the details, and having that in mind, I'm just going to quickly go over what my plans are. I'm changing one of my deputy positions to that of an office operations supervisor. I'm changing two tax listing clerk positions to administrative assistants and hiring one new tax listing clerk to replace a retiring employee. These are all positions that I have in my office now, so I'm not adding any positions, personnel. And the financial requirement is actually $5,800 and some odd less than what's presently in my budget. So since you have the letter, if you have any questions that I didn't answer in that letter, I'll be happy to try to answer those now.
We appreciate the fact, number one, that you're saving some money. That's number one fact. But does anyone have any questions?
I don't have any questions. I'd just like to thank you, Sharon, for doing this prior to our budget cycle starting again. It's very hard, I think, in mid-year when we have things come up and we're shifting and changing around. So thank you for doing this on the front of our budget process. Yeah. Thank you.
All right. Do I have a motion that we approve this request?
Motion.
Motion second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. That passes. All right. You also have in your packet the updated financial data and the
personnel vacancy report. So, Mr. Chairman, concludes our report.
Thank you, Mr. Walker. No items under eligibility today.
Yes, sir.
Keith, Sheriff, and having to come back at 5:30, I'll support it as well.
Sound like you're good to go, Ms. West.
Thank you.
You go take care of the tax receipts.
Next, we have public safety and, well, skip that as long as you care. Can we move that, Councilman, legally?
You wanted to skip that committee?
Yeah, just since my office is not here, it should be here. I'm moving it around. Let's go to land use, right behind it. Maybe Michael City will be here at 4:00. Land use, Jeff, Chairman Jane Hall, Justin Bradley, members. First item, update for area performance planning. Bob Hartrecker here, planning director for Berlin. Bob, how you doing today?
Just fine, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon.
Good.
Good afternoon. Give me just a second. Mr. Bradley is going to help me. Mr. Chairman, good afternoon.
Yes, sir.
We can go back.
We want to proceed, or have we, we'll go ahead and proceed? Yeah, go ahead. Our way. You are the key. Bring my fueling prior, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm here this afternoon to give you an update on our area performance planning process. As you all know, County Council authorized us to undertake a performance planning process. That was an outgrowth of your strategic planning process last year. We like to think that for us that we're part of the purposeful planning. I'm not working either. This is not a good day for me. The purposeful plan part of the mission statement that you adopted. It is an outgrowth of the process that you adopted before. And that's the reason that we're going for. But this process, it literally is a balance between quality of life and economic development. We've seen a number of economic development successes over the past year or so. I think everyone realizes that it's important to balance those successes with the great quality of life that we've got here in the county. I know I've been here just a little over 2 years, and the quality of life here is outstanding. There's just all sorts of things to do. You see that every month from the Livability Committee that Jane chairs. Just
pull that microphone close to you, Bob.
Across the board.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, is that better, Mr. Chairman?
That's what it does.
Thank you. So literally, we're striking a balance between the quality of life that our residents enjoy and the growth and development that we know is coming. We talk about, once again, economic development projects virtually every meeting. And it's important that we protect the homeowners and all those things that we hold dear here in the county and protect those interests while at the same time making sure that we encourage that growth. So with area performance planning, we've got a quantitative and a qualitative process. Quantitative, the best way to look at that is to consider that as empirical data. That's just data that helps you in decision making, that helps you decide what you're going to do. Qualitative is the citizen input, stakeholder input part of this process. We're going to talk about both of those. And some of these slides you've seen before, and some of them I will be new to you. We think with the quantitative side of things that we've got, we're using growth projectors as a guide. We talked about that before. We're using growth classifications as a methodology for implementing the performance plan. On the qualitative side, we're community-based. We've got a vision for the community that we use through public forums and stakeholder meetings. within the district. Here is, here's some slides on the quantitative side. You can see here, these are slides by Clemson University, the Strong Thurmond Institute at Clemson. And they show density of growth in the upstate. And if you look at these slides, and I know that they're hard to see for those in the audience, but this is the Greenville urban area. This is the Spartanburg urban area. And these show urban growth in 1990 to 2000, projected 2010 to 2020, and projected 2020 to 2030. And you can just see the darker the color, the more dense that things get. And so there's a lot of growth projected for this area, and I think we all know that. There are other studies. Here's another study from North Carolina State University. It shows projected urban land cover in the year 2060. And it literally covers the eastern seaboard right here, Spartanburg and Greenville, sort of right in the middle of all that. That 85 corridor is a strong spine for that growth. So in implementing this process, we use freeways, arterials, collectors, and local roads as the main implementation methodology. We talked about this once again before, and these are things that citizens can relate to and are things that you know that are tangible that you can see. And once again, I'm here. These three maps show, once again, I know they're very hard to see, but they show traffic growth in the Spartanburg urban area in the year 1987, 1997, 2007, and 2012. These are maps from the South Carolina Department of Transportation. Generally, the darker the line and the thicker the lines, the more the traffic. And particularly if you focus on 87, 2012, you can see the real difference in terms of growth of traffic as a direct result of the growth that we're experiencing in this area. These maps are density maps of person per square mile. They're for years 1990, 2000, and 2010 across the board here. Particularly, I think if you compare 1990 and 2010, you'll see strong growth in the Bowling Springs area, in the southwest area, which is the first area that we're looking at in our process. Just once again, a means of quantifying the growth that we're seeing. These two maps are maps that are the 2010 density map, and they just sort of, they juxtapose that against the other map, which are the five areas that County Council approved for us to look at. And of course, we're focusing now on the blue area, the southwest area. So we talk about quantitative things, we'll talk a little bit about qualitative measures. We're asking the committee consider both the appointment advisory and technical committees that would assist us in advising the planning commission staff about this process and our efforts going forward. We think that the advisory committee would serve as an advisor and sounding board to the planning commission and our project team. They provide guidance and oversight, and they're an advocate for the project and for the process in terms of the way that we're approaching area performance planning. The membership would consist of the chairman of the planning commission. This is on the advisory committee. The council member or members from each district. Real estate development representatives, to include commercial developer, residential builder developer, real estate agents. A transportation representative, which we would identify as the Spartanburg County Public Works Director. Large landowners, employers, and informal community leaders. The technical committee, the advisory technical committee, is more technical in nature, and that they would advise staff and the planning commission with regard to the specific, you know, technical aspects of any ordinance development or whatever we would do. These would be individuals that actually practice in the field, that interact with the county on a weekly, monthly basis with development projects. The membership of the technical committee will consist of large-scale residential and multifamily developer representatives, commercial real estate developer representatives, engineers, to include the Spartanburg County engineer, and representatives from the engineering community that actually practice engineering in Spartanburg County. Transportation representatives from SCDOT and from SPATS, land use attorneys, environmental community representatives, and informal community leaders. So once again, establishment of an advisory committee, a technical advisory committee, to help guide this process, both with somewhat similar but different charges in terms of what we would be asking them to do. In addition to those committees, we would have a number of stakeholders. You can see them here. Those would include citizens and individuals within those different categories that you see outlined there. Once again, we're doing everything that we can to try to get input from a broad spectrum of folks with respect to this process. Finally, Mr. Chairman, this is my last slide. This is a slide that superimposes here our planning, Southwest planning area that you've authorized us to undertake, with a map that shows it relative to the rest of the county here. But within the first map, it shows county council districts and how, for this area, there are two predominant county council districts. Those are council districts 4 and 6. And so as a result of that, with this process and the appointment of these individuals, we relied on Councilwoman Call and Councilwoman Nutt with respective advice with regard to who those individuals would be. And I think, Mr. Chairman, that's pretty much all that I have. I believe Ms. O'Neill may want to say a few words with respect to who these members would be. But I'll start with that, ask any questions. And once again, I apologize for the early technical difficulties.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As Bob indicated, we've been working with Vice Chairman Hall and with Councilman Nutt on individuals who would be good representatives in the southwestern core of the planning area. And at your seat, we provided a listing of suggested individuals for the technical advisory subcommittee, as well as the stakeholder groups. So these groups would not be necessarily seen as a standing or ad hoc committee that council would appoint, but more in line with a working citizen committee. So unless council has any objection to us moving forward in this regard, Bob and I would work with Vice Chairman Hall and Councilman Nutt to contact these individuals and start moving the process forward.
Okay, any questions for Mr. Hill or Mr. Hardwick?
Can I get you to flip back, if you can find it, to the slide that shows about the roads, Carter's, Arterius, Arterius, and so forth. I want to ask you a question there. I believe it was behind it before that.
Hey, that was it.
Is that it?
Or about it?
Those are density. It's the one that had all the list and the type of roads that you had. There was no pictures.
I'm sorry.
That one right there.
Yes, sir.
All right. We talk in terms, these are not really specific. They're the general terms that we're looking at. And we say local roads down there that may be unpaved. Well, are we counting roads that need to be paved or in bad pavement situation? My concern is we're developing a plan on roads and how to get to and so forth. And if we don't bring these roads up, then we're going to be behind the eight ball to start with. And that's my concern, Mr. Chairman, is that we're, and I'm not saying we don't do this, but my concern is we've got roads that don't meet where they need to be, and we're going to say, okay, this is going to be how we're going to own collectors or freeways or whatever is going to be there is based on the condition of those roads. We know most of them are not in good condition. So I'm concerned there is how we're going to bring those roads up to the standards that we want them to be in order so that we, when we set this plan up and do it, that we're handling it
Good point.
Catherine, you got a response?
Sure. Councilman Walker, the performance planning is largely focused on land use. And so as part of the process, we'll be inventorying roads and how they perform in the community now as traffic collectors. Of course, as part of that process, the planning data that we gather on them would be important to bring to the Public Works Committee so that we can talk about future improvements. I know Councilman Nutt has talked about in some of these areas that he and Vice Chairman Hall are looking at, some of the roads may be considered a local road right now because they don't have a lot of traffic, there's a lot of open land. But as the development is continuing, they're really serving more as a collector, and that we need to work through our planning process to kind of get ahead of that with the improvements. And I think that's really what you're driving at.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
But for the area performance planning process, that would be geared more for helping to gather the data to help council with making those types of decisions in your planning process that was separate from this and more in the Public Works Committee, if that helps.
I would think that the data that we collect as we go through this process is going to probably identify areas and needs that may have been under the radar for a while. So I look at this as a positive way to identify those things, either things that are being affected today or in the near future as growth continues. But primarily, we're looking at the growth parameters at this time so that we designate and identify that if someone is going to put an industry on an arterial road, there will be certain expectations versus if they wanted to go onto a collector or a local road, then there would be different expectations of them to protect the surrounding area, the natural resources, and the people who are located there now. So, you know, this is really a protection thing for individual residents who may live in the local roads area, rural roads, whatever, and also to identify things that we expect as we continue with our growth and our planning, that we expect industry or other businesses to understand and take advisement when they locate.
Absolutely. And to Councilman Walker's point, so some of the roads, I know that it mentions unpaved in this slide. Some of the roads that we're talking about are actually paved and they're not wide enough. We've been working in the Public Works Committee on the infrastructure fund for the next budget and talked about, for example, Snow Road, the public-private partnership that we're working on to try to widen, will be already a paved road that's turning into a more heavily trafficked road. So I think that's where you're headed, but I wanted to be sure that we're going to be addressing those types of concerns. It may just be separate from the area performance planning process.
Roger.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, thank Councilman Hall and staff. We've all been working very diligently on this process. A lot of it has been done away from this full council. We're trying to get it right so that because this is the first one and there's going to be four others, I guess, that will come after this, and so we want to make sure we get it at least close to being right. I'm sure it will be added to. I wanted to comment on what you asked, Councilman Walker, and this was before you and Justice Thomas, so just for your benefit, when this was brought up, one of the main things that really put this idea over the top was that it included council's commitment to infrastructure. And we had our strategic planning meeting, and one of the main things that we brought out of that was that what government does and should do very well is to provide for its infrastructure and make sure that we not only grow, but we have the resources to do that, and that growth is not waiting on us. So if we do have some of those roads, we say, yeah, you can put up subdivision on that road, but yet as it stands right now, we go, oh, well, not that road, and keep going on that road. So it's we're kind of limited, but I think with this process, one of the things we're trying to do is that when we identify those roads, that we do is, as our administrator has said, that we identify
that we've got some infrastructure, and if the growth is coming there, and that's where people are going, and that's a snow road is a great, you know, who would have thought 5 years ago that that's the new booming area? But it is, not because we've decided that, but because the market has decided that. And then we got to go in there and say, okay, we can't stop people from letting the market take care of itself, so we've got to put in the infrastructure and make sure that we've got what it needs to grow. Can't do that with everybody because we've got limited funds, but we've taken a big step with the Steve Blue Fund, and hopefully that will grow over time and we'll be able to do more things. But I think that in conjunction with what we're doing here, I think separately that these two things would probably fail. But together, if we have the designation and we have the commitment to infrastructure, I think this could be a fantastic thing for Spartanburg County. So Councilman Hall for her effort so far. She's done a lot of work on this, and we hope to get this right and we get everybody's input. And I think, just for the council's benefit, we've got a good list of people here who have been called on, and they have said they would dedicate their time to this very important process. Everybody on this list has said this process can work and that we are for this process, and we need to move forward. And hopefully that's going to be a great team building. Thank you, Spartanburg County.
Thank you, Bob. Catherine, one thing I just thought of, and I hate to bring this on you a minute, but think about it. I didn't see any school district representatives here, board members or superintendents, but nothing in our area turned the road from a local road to a collector road like a school district put in another school. So we may need to bring them into the mix.
Sure. Ironically, the school districts are actually excluded from the Planning Enabling Act as far as being
a part of.
But we have been working with the school district superintendents to bring them into the planning process so that we can work together as a team in planning where school sites are envisioned. So I would anticipate that you'll be hearing more about that in the weeks and months to come.
Well, I would still love to be able to figure out some way that when they're talking about moving or building another school in a different area, which District 2 continuously does. And my girlfriend is on the school board, which is my wife. She won't even tell me. You know, when I don't know about it, I read about it in the paper because they always do it in the executive session. But with that being said, we need to get some input from them on where they're headed so that we can properly plan, because it really affects us in
And unofficially, I have been talking with the school superintendents as we've gone through this process. So most of them are aware of what we're doing, what we're attempting to do. But as Catherine said, I think there's some state things that either prohibit or kind of we have to circumvent in order to get them officially on board.
All right. Any other questions for Bob and Catherine? Just receiving information today. All right, thank you very much. Now we're back up to Honorable Public Safety and Judiciary, Honorable Michael Brown, Chairman Roger Nutt, Bob Walker, Member Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Former Chief Ron Orenbrock is here to provide some wonderful, needed information in terms of introducing a new Fire Chief of Poplar Springs.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, members of council. It's my pleasure. Many of you may know that I'm retiring July 4th, going out with a bang. But I just wanted to come this afternoon and thank you, and then introduce our new Department Chief, Chief Tommy Norris.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, Council. It's nice to be back home in Spartanburg again. Thank you for this recognizing me. I look forward to working with each one of you, staff, and the citizens of Poplarsburg. Thank you very much.
Where did you come from?
I was in Allendale, South Carolina. I actually worked in Charleston County, but it's a tax district, Allendale Fire Department. Okay. But I'm from Bowling Springs.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Have a good retirement.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Chairman. Next on the receive information, take desired action in reference to the VAWA, Violence Against Women Act grant. Mr. Murray Glenn from the Solicitor's Office here will give us some information.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, members of the council. It's good to see you. This grant here is a continuation of the successful partnership we've had going on with the state for years. The local match is already built into our budget, and we simply just ask for your blessing and our ongoing fight against domestic violence. Thank you. Any questions? Happy to build for you. Thank you.
Entertain a motion as relates to the submittal of the grant application. Please.
Right. You see that grant application in the package?
I move we accept the request.
Proceed to move.
I'll second.
All right.
I trust you.
We've been properly moved and seconded as relates to the submittal of the grant application. The purpose of the Violence Against Women Act.
Right.
All in favor, let it be known by.
Aye.
None opposed. We'll send this to full council for consideration. Next, we receive information, take desired action in reference to a 2015 Local Emergency Management Performance Grant. Doug Bryson, our coordinator of Spartanburg County Emergency Management Service, received.
Good afternoon. First, before we get into this, just wanted to make everybody aware that, as usually happens during these meetings, there are severe thunderstorms coming, probably within the next hour or two. So if you're on the code red system, make sure that your phones are on vibrate, because it is a significant line of storms at the Georgia line right now headed this way. So, back to this. This is an annual performance grant that we are awarded by FEMA. There is no hard money match is any kind match, and this supports our operations and sustains what programs we already have in place, and also special projects, and allows us to upgrade any equipment. One of the main special projects that I have in place for this money this year is to expand our public notification system, like you see here in the administration building, with the video monitors, with the information and the radar and the weather announcements. Been speaking with Hope Blackley, and we'd like to expand that project into the judicial center, so that should give us funding to take care of that as well too. But it's just basically a course of action for approval. It's a grant that we are approved for by the federal government every year.
Questions? Thank you, Bill.
Thank you.
Can I entertain a motion as relates to the approval of submitting the grant application for this local emergency management performance grant?
So moved.
Second.
Probably moved in a second. Are there any other questions? Not. You approve this, let me know as aye.
Aye.
None opposed. We'll send this to full council for consideration. Thank you. Next, receive information, take desired action in reference to authorizing the commission of Christopher Aaron Wyatt, Animal Control Officer, as a Spartanburg County Code Enforcement Officer. It's a simple request, Jamie, as I understand it. Self-explanatory, so I'll entertain a motion as it relates to authorizing this commission.
So moved.
Second.
Probably moved to second. Any questions or discussion? If not, all in favor, let it be known. On the side of aye.
Aye.
None opposed. We'll send this on the full council for consideration. And last, receive information, take desired action in reference to the Greenville County Animal Services contract. Our county administrator is going to give us some information.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In your agenda packet, you have a copy of an extension of our agreement with Greenville County to assist us with animal services. This would be an opportunity for us to extend a good partnership. They've been very helpful in working with us.
Questions?
Can I, Ms. O'Neill, just to make sure that we, being new, is this is a continuation of the contract that we've got right now, right?
Yes, sir. It's not, no change in the terms.
Right, and if I understand correctly, I don't see the copy I had, the number three on, that is for multiple years, but we do have the right to get out of the contract. Either side has the right to get out of the contract, right?
Yes, sir, for planning purposes, this would extend our contract to 2017, and there's an opportunity for us to renew up to three additional times for one-year terms.
That's right, from full council, I entertain a motion as relates to approving this contract and authorizing our county administrator to execute.
So moved.
Appears it may not make it out of our committee. This has been moved, and as I understand, it won't be seconded. So for the purposes of bringing this before full council, I'll second the motion. With that, hand turn over to Roger. To move it along, since I seconded the motion.
Call for the question?
Yes.
All right, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Yeah, let's have it, we'll.
And we'll send this on full council for its consideration.
Thank you.
That's all matters that come before the committee.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. All right, no items on the public works today, other than what's in your packet. And this concludes our committees, and we will meet with our graduates at 5:00, and have our meeting at 5:30, and if you're leaving, be careful in the storms today. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your patience. Earlier today, we had our committee meetings. First item on the agenda is our invocation, so I'd call on Chaplain Angus Durham, please. Render our invocation. Mr. Durham, how are you today, sir? Great, thank you. Thanks for being here, sir.
All stand. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we thank you for allowing us to see another day. Thank you for the blessings that you have brought our way. Come, our Father, thanking you for the peace you bring in our lives, for when we pray and call upon your name and enter your presence, it gives us peace that passes all understanding. We pray that you continue to protect us and provide for us throughout all that we desire to do and become. We pray your purpose will continue to be fulfilled in our lives. Let us know that you're in charge of all that we do and all that we can ever become. We pray much for our council meeting tonight, that you will guide us and lead us through it. We continue to ask your hands upon all the leadership throughout Spartanburg County government and county council and the work that they do. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Mr. Durham. And I would like to thank you for your diligence to this council. At this time, I'd like to call on Captain. Okay, one more. All right. You may see. Leo, just give me instructions for a moment. All right. Okay. Captain, the great meeting we had Friday morning, Sheriff's Office, I did a tremendous job. We ready.
Ladies and gentlemen, keep it tradition, we ask everyone stand and remain silent during the closing of our national state call. Lieutenant Prophet, the color is present.
Sir.
Color is present. Set the color.
Yes, sir.
Carry colors.
Forward. Hook. Breathe in. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Order.
Mr. Chairman and members of council, the Steve Young National Honor Guard competition, which is sponsored by the Fraternal Order of Police, occurs every May 14th as part of National Police Week. The National Honor Guard competition and demonstration provides an opportunity for law enforcement organizations to perform ceremonious and patriotic tributes for public viewing. These teams are a highly dedicated group of law enforcement officers who represent organizations from all across this nation and Canada. They converge on the nation's capital every year for National Police Week, where peace officers are honored for their dedicated service to the protection of our communities. The day of May 15th is known as National Peace Officers Memorial Day, a day when the nation honors those officers who have made the ultimate sacrifice. This event is the tribute these teams give to honor our fallen officers and their families. The Spartanburg County Sheriff's Rifle Team, Drill Team, has just returned from Washington, D.C., where they competed against 19 other national teams and placed fourth behind the U.S. Border Patrol, U.S. Capitol Police, and the Tennessee Highway Patrol. The competition was judged by the military attachment, which is also responsible for the guard at the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, and is a very difficult and coveted prize. Congratulations, gentlemen. The team members who competed were Captain Alan Freeman, Captain Randy Hollifield, Corporal Jeremy Thomas, Deputy Cameron Bridges, Sergeant Brian Likers, Lieutenant Terry Cody, Sergeant Robert Atkins, Deputy Derek McBriar, Lieutenant William Robson, and Deputy John Wright. Council, I know that you'll join me in sharing that we are very proud of these deputies and the great national recognition that they have brought for Spartanburg County and Sheriff Chuck Wright. And if you'll turn your attention to the screens, please, we have a video for you.
presentations. We have item A, a presentation by the SCEA, South Carolina Economic Development Association Distinguished Service Award, Carter Smith, and a representative from SCEA here for to present.
Mr. Chairman, council members, thank you. I come to you on two accounts today. One, as the treasurer of the Economic Development Association, and then two, as his colleague. I thought I may just read a couple things from the nomination process about Carter. We solicited letters from, I've reached out to about 10 of our peers around the state, including Bobby Hitt, Max Metcalf, and BMW. In every, it's 100%. Everyone submitted their nomination letters in support of Carter for this Distinguished Service Award, which they don't give out every year. They've only given out a handful of times over the 50 years of the existence of SCEA. But Carter has spent 32 wildly successful years in economic development spread across Spartanburg, York County, and Jasper County. He was a pioneer in economic development, being one of the first in South Carolina to gain his nationally recognized professional accreditation as a CECD in 1987. Over his storied career, Carter was directly involved in billions of announced capital investment and the creation of thousands upon thousands of jobs. In the last 5 years alone in Spartanburg County, he, along with Your Health, has accounted for over $3.87 billion in capital investment and the creation of nearly 7,000 jobs. It's been my pleasure to know Carter for the past 13 years, but it was only through the last 6 years of working side by side with him that I've fully come to appreciate his value, both professionally and personally. Carter has taught me much more than the X's and O's of economic development. Carter Smith has shown me how to be a better father, a better husband, a better citizen, and a flat-out better person. It's this legacy he will leave in South Carolina that justifies him being named the recipient of the SCEA Distinguished Service Award. It's this legacy we should all aspire to. Thank you.
Thank you.
With that, present Carter with this one.
Teammate right there at Angie, got a great family, and around me,
You know, Carter always gives everybody else the credit, Brian Nash, Royal Comer, in the councils we work with, the chamber presidents. Now we've got a really exciting chamber president, Alan Smith, right out there. You ain't seen nothing yet. So the team that we have in place with these seven council members up here, they all get it. We haven't always had it with seven council members that always got it. There've been some, you know, we had to drag along. But this team up here now, they get it. In our administration, Catherine and Carter and Brian and I talk probably 4 to 5 times a week, or days a week, many times for that email and texting. But it's the team, again, our staff, whether, you know, whatever county department, everybody gets it, even the citizens. So that's why Spartanburg sets all these records. This award that Carter gets, that was given, has only been awarded 6 times in 50 years. So it doesn't happen, like Brian said, every year, only 6 times. And that says a lot about Carter and about the team that he has together. So thank you, Carter, for the work you do all the time. And Brian and Angie and everybody else up there now.
Thank you very much. We appreciate that. And I'm sure Angie agrees. You and I talk more than I do to some of my family.
Probably our wives. Yeah, because we don't talk that long. We listen and get off.
Exactly. You got it. Thank you very much. All of y'all. Appreciate it very much.
Thank you, Carter. Next, we have item B, a resolution congratulating and recognizing Hunter Jolly for being named South Carolina Education Association Teacher of the Month, February 2015, being named as a finalist for the 2015 Teacher of the Year. Mr. Justin Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'm honored to be able to recognize Mr. Jolly too. I'm going to have your family come down and join us as well. And I see Mr. Chuck's word as well from the Mullinsland High School Principal. I'd like to come down and join us as well to present this. I'm particularly proud to present this, not just because I get to present this to a great teacher and someone who's really inspiring our students, but also because it's from my alma mater, the Woods Creek High School. I'm proud to have graduated from there, and I know we have a great team at Woods Creek High School. And I know, you know, we're here to recognize Mr. Jolly, but you know, I know you stand in the gap for a lot of teachers that often don't get things done for we appreciate their work. So this is a resolution congratulating and recognizing Hunter Jolly for being named the South Carolina Education Association's Teacher of the Month for February 2015 and being named as a finalist for the 2015 South Carolina Teacher of the Year. Whereas pride and honor have been bestowed upon Spartanburg County by the achievements of Hunter Jolly being named the South Carolina Education Association's Teacher of the Month for February 2015 and being named as finalist for the 2015 South Carolina Teacher of the Year. And whereas he is a chemistry and environmental sciences teacher at Lone Springs High School in Spartanburg County District 2, whereas Hunter Jolly was named District 2 Teacher of the Year for 2014 and Lone Springs High School's 2014 Teacher of the Year, whereas he is extremely active in educational leadership both on and off school campus by being the district's inaugural lead science instructor, serving as a board member on the South Carolina Science Council, being an adjunct professor in elementary education at USC, being an educational consultant with Gardner Webb, serving as editor for the SC Smarter Balance Digital Library, and serving as junior class advisor and prom advisor at Lone Springs High School. And now, for there be it resolved that Spartanburg County Council does hereby recognize Hunter Jolly for his contributions to the total education experience through his quality career guidance. Be it further resolved that this resolution be presented to Hunter Jolly in recognition thereof and be made a part of the permanent minutes of Spartanburg County Council adopted this 18th day of May 2015. Attested Catherine L. O'Neill, County Administrator, and signed by Spartanburg County Council Chairman Jim Fortin. Mr. Chairman, I move that we adopt this resolution.
I have a motion.
Second.
Any other discussion? Mr. Gordon, I'm in there every Thanksgiving at least, and that school still looks as good as it did when I graduated in 1978. You're doing a fine job over there.
Thank you for that. You've got a fine person to show you. Of course, for this
meeting. Sir, thank you. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote for the passes. Thank you, Mr. Gordon.
Thank you.
Recognition of our graduates of the Spartanburg County Citizens Academy. I'm told we have the best looking and the smartest. Well, I know you're fearless leader, Mr. Cat River. That has to be true.
First, we have Walter Belton.
Mr. Belton.
One second. Finally, we get something right around here, first thing. Sheena Brown, how are you today? Mr. Bullson. How are you today? Davis Dawkins. Larry Eastman. Got them bulldog covers tonight. Shirley Glenn. Donna Harris. Tisha Jones, everyone's color coordinated. Lily McKay. Still McIntyre. I knew I didn't have any hard names tonight because Kathy didn't coach me before. Now, wait a minute now. Alora Carter. Did I get that right?
Yes, sir.
All right. My phonics paid off. Alora's friend. Regina Ray. Again, thank you. I heard nothing but great comments, even when they came forward tonight talking about what a great job you've done at the county staff with this Citizens Academy. And I would invite all of the residents, if you want to learn more about the county government, it's a very good class. And you get to meet a lot of different people, learn a lot about how your tax dollars are being spent and who controls what. And so again, I thank you for your dedication. And earlier today, we had our committees. We need a lot of people on committees. So hopefully, Kathy, you will continue to generate prospects from this group, from that as well. But Kathy, thank you and your team for the leadership. Anyone want to say anything?
She did a marvel.
Oh, wonderful. Wonderful. Great. Thank you. All right, they have something they'd like to present.
Thank you. we had a class of 2015, we'd like to present Kathy with a love offering. I want you to know that we appreciate your hospitality and the way you carry yourself.
Kathy, this was the 16th class, Kathy?
That's correct.
16th class, so thank you very much for your participation. Process, item three, employee recognition, Catherine O'Neill, Administrator.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's always my pleasure to recognize our extended family members. So the individuals that I'm going to be recognizing tonight, they may not have Spartanburg County on their pay voucher, but I can tell you that they dedicate their time to us as if they did. So I am Doug Bryson first. I want to thank you for bringing this team to my attention and to give us the opportunity tonight to recognize them. As I call your name, if you'll stand up, Kristen James. Hi, Kristen. Kristen is the disaster coordinator with the Spartanburg Area Mental Health. I'm going to introduce some the members of her team. Stephanie Kerrigan. Hi, Stephanie. Linda Grady. Linda, you're with Greenville Mental Health. Greg Merritt. Greg serves with the South Carolina FAST coordinator. He's with Clear Springs Fire and Rescue. Fergie Horvath, did I get that right? Close. Fergie. She's the chaplain. She's the chaplain with the Spartanburg County Sheriff's Office. Keith Davis. Hey, Keith. Keith is the pastor of Zion Hill Baptist Church. And Tommy Sparks. Hi, Tommy. Pastor of Packlet Baptist Church. So this team responded to the psychological and mental health needs of the first responders who were at the tragic accident on I-26 that claimed the lives of six people. Kristen responded to a call from Doug Bryson at 4 a.m. Kristen, I've gotten those calls before too, so I love you for responding. And assembled a team. You actually were the hero here. They provided counseling on scene as well as helping with the ongoing needs of our responders. While the Department of Mental Health is a key partner in our plans and exercises, this was the first true real-time response, and everyone was very impressed and very grateful. These professionals are unsung heroes and a great asset in the time of need. These mental health professionals provided valuable counseling to the coroner staff and other emergency response professionals in a time that we honestly hope never happens. I'd like to also read an email that came from our coroner, Rusty Clevenger. He couldn't be here this evening. He wanted to share his appreciation. He said he was notified of the recognition of this team today. He said, unfortunately, I had a prior engagement and unable to attend. He said, I agree wholeheartedly that Kristen and her team are unsung heroes and a great asset in time of need. She and the other mental health professionals provided valuable counseling to my staff and other emergency response professionals in a time that we really hope never happens. In reality, it does. Please extend my heartfelt thanks and gratitude to their team for helping us. So, Council, will you join me in thanking this extended family of ours? Thank you so much. Yes, Chairman, that's all I have.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next, we go to item four, public hearing. Item eight, I need to announce that we are working through details of this one with the city, and we have not finalized. And we will schedule a second public hearing once we have incorporated those details into the ordinance policies and project review. item, close that public hearing, open item B, to consider a budget ordinance related to the fiscal affairs of Spartanburg County, making appropriations therefore, levying taxes for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2015, and ending June 30th, 2016, to provide for a budget control of said appropriation by Spartanburg County Council. Anyone to speak on behalf of item B, the budget ordinance tonight? Close B, open C, to consider a budget ordinance to establish capital projects budgets for the 2015-2016 budget year of the five-year capital improvement plan. Anyone to speak on behalf of this public hearing? Done, same, close C, open D, to consider an application for a special public event exclusion from the Nord's ordinance requested by Greer Dragway from 4 p.m. to midnight on Saturday, June 13, 2015, and Saturday, June 27, 2015, for a drag race at 1792 Dragway Road, Greer. Anyone speak on behalf of this public hearing? Done, same. Open item E, to consider an application for a special public event exclusion from the Nord's ordinance requested by Boiling Springs Ale House from 7 p.m. to 10 p.m. on Thursday, June 11, 2015, and from 3 p.m. until 8 p.m. on Saturday, June 20, 2015, for a live music outside 2220 Boiling Springs Road, Boiling Springs. We did have some individuals sign up to speak. And have first, we have John Rogers of 816 Tappanzer Lane. John, are you here?
Yes, sir. Good evening, Mr. Chairman and County Council. Put my glasses on so I can see. I'm the president of the Sterling Estates HOA Board. On May 11th, we met for a regular scheduled executive session. The outdoor concerts at the Ale House and how it would affect our residents were discussed in that meeting. There were several concerns that were communicated to me by my fellow board members, as this event has been compared to Music on Main by the owners and managers of the Ale House. The first, obviously, was the noise that the outdoor concert will bring residents of Sterling Estates. And although it does not affect the whole subdivision, it does very loudly disturb some of the residents. It can be heard inside many of those homes that are on Chippendale Lane. Secondly, this event is for profit. We understand that it does create a gathering place for Boiling Springs community, but unlike Music on Main, it only generates income for the Ale House and not for the surrounding businesses. We do understand that all businesses want to market themselves in many ways as possible, but the Ale House has an indoor stage that will allow live bands to play for their patrons, keeping the noise inside. They also have a patio outside that allows the people to mingle as well. In the end, we all agreed that if this noise ordinance exemption was for a one-time fundraiser for someone or something in the community, we may be more open, but it's simply to bring more business to the Ale House, and we see no compromise in this matter. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Charles Wyatt, 518 Chippendale.
Thank you, members of the council, again this month. We talked about the noise ordinance and the exemption, and the one point that I think we wanted to point out was, again, we're not opposed to, and I said at the last meeting, not opposed to outdoor events at the Ale House, it's the music amplification. The unlawful amplifications in section 3031 says to operate or allow the operation of any sound amplification equipment as to carry sounds which is so unreasonably loud and unseemly to disturb others beyond the premises to which the equipment is located. And that's the problem. It's the amplification in their parking lot. If it stayed in their parking lot, we'd have no problem with that, but it's permeating throughout the apartment complex, Eagle Point. We had a citizen last time here at Eagle Point. So his windows are vibrating at his house, and then of course over in Sterling Estates. So we'd ask you just to please consider staying by the spirit of this ordinance, especially the part about amplification, not being selfish for just our residents, for the Boiling Springs community. the precedent that this was set. This last business was here last time and asked for 5 days. Now they're back asking for a couple more. And again, we're just worried about this Pandora's box. If this is granted once, will it continue to be granted? So would ask you to please vote to keep the noise ordinance as it is. Thank you.
Thank you. And Justin McCorkle.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, council. My name is Justin McCorkle. I have a very rich history here in Spartanburg County. My father was a founding member of the Marshall Tucker Band. And with that said, I'm the Justin McCorkle Band that we get booked out of the L House quite a bit. To me, I really can't explain that this is a good problem to have to me, because it shows economic growth throughout our area, and especially Boiling Springs. What a thriving community, and it's great. And although I do understand that, you know, it was a little bit loud last time, I want everybody to understand that the stage has been moved. But this time of the year, there's leaves on the trees. Everything is not pointing in that direction anymore. Everything's pointed in the opposite direction of the way it was. And I cannot explain how much it is not our goal to upset anyone. We want everybody to join in the fun. We want everybody to enjoy the music and the arts. And although the L House does, you know, they are the ones that are making money, they're generating income, it also pays us. And we're bands that, you know, we do this pretty much professionally. It stops at 10 a.m. I personally would not ever want anything to go over 10 a.m. That's myself. You know, I don't think that anybody's trying to turn it into a party town or anything like that. I see it as more of the music and arts thriving in our area. I mean, our Spartanburg County is huge for the music and arts. We're known throughout the world for, you know, the talent that's come from this area. And I think it's just something that would be good for other bands to be able to, you know, keep that going. We have a variety of followers in my personal band, actually. We have a couple doctor's offices that were represented last time at the L House. And I certainly understand the concern, you know, for the noise. And after I thought about it last time, you know, my focus is going in there, doing the show the best I can to where the venue wants me, that, you know, they book me. They want me to do a certain show, and that's what I thrive to do, is to satisfy the person that booked me. And then, you know, quite honestly, I certainly didn't have any thoughts of the sound going as far as it did or whatever. So I know that those guys have made a big push to change the stage around, as well as, you know, like I said, leaves being on the trees, children out of school. And I think that I think it'll be a little bit different scenario this time. And, you know, we did book an outdoor PA system for that, because we were asked to do an outdoor live show. Live music is a little bit loud, I understand, but we certainly don't want to make anybody mad. Certainly don't want anybody being mad at the music and the arts in Spartanburg. We want everybody to come out and join us. So that's kind of where we're standing on that right now.
Thank you, Mr. McCall.
Thank you.
Okay. Closes item eight. Earlier today, we had our committee reports. First committee was Economic Improvement and Development. Honorable David Britt, Chairman. Mr. Britt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We had six items presented for the council. The committee met. On the first item, we recommend the full council. We render first reading to an ordinance authorizing, pursuant to Chapter 44, Title 12, the execution delivery of fee agreement between Spartanburg County and Rite Aid of Georgia, Inc. and Flatwood Farms 1, LLC. I move that we approve on first reading.
We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative and it passes.
Next item, the committee recommends the full council to adopt a resolution authorizing the execution and delivery of an inducement agreement by and between Spartanburg County, South Carolina, and Bahrain, Inc. Move that we adopt this resolution.
I have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative and it passes.
Committee recommends we render first reading to an ordinance authorizing the execution and delivery of a special source credit agreement between Spartanburg County and Bahrain, Inc. We approve on first reading.
Have a motion.
Sorry.
Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, it passes.
Committee recommends to full council that we adopt a resolution authorizing certain, under certain conditions, the execution and delivery by Spartanburg County of a fee in lieu tax agreement for project kickoff with respect to the industrial project in the county, whereby the project would be subject to payment of certain fee in lieu of taxes, and whereby project kickoff would be provided certain tax credits, hence fee payments, and reimbursement of investment related qualified infrastructure improvements. Move that we adopt this resolution.
We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All favor, raise your right hand. Opposed, no vote affirmative.
Committee also recommends that we render first reading to an ordinance authorizing the execution and delivery of a fee loan agreement between Spartanburg County and project kickoff with respect to certain economic development property in the county. Move that we adopt this resolution. I mean, we render first reading.
We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, no vote affirmative, and it passes.
The last item, committee recommends the full council that we render first reading to an ordinance to amend the agreement for development of a joint county industrial business park dated as of June 25th, 2001, by between Spartanburg County and Cherokee County, South Carolina. I move that we adopt, I move that we approve on first reading.
So we have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. And opposed, no vote affirmative, passes.
Mr. Chairman, that concludes our committee report.
Thank you, Mr. Britt. Committee is for me to say we want more.
Yes, sir. All right. We got more coming.
Don't stop. No items under public health. We did have a couple items under personnel and finance. Honorable Bob Walker, Chairman. Mr. Walker.
Mr. Chairman, Personnel and Finance Committee is here earlier, and we took up two items. First, we received information in reference to the Accommodation Tax Advisory Committee, and approved those recommendations. We took those under advisement. Number two is that we received information and took desired action in reference to restructuring the staff in the auditor's office. Move for adoption.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, affirmative, passes.
Mr. Chairman, completes that.
Ms. O'Neill.
Mr. Chairman, in your committee, under the Accommodation Tax Advisory Committee, I think earlier today, you did talk about, needed to talk later about the recommendations, but I was under the impression that you had taken a vote to postpone or to defer the item until the next meeting.
We did. We
well, basically, did. I think what he said, we just took it under advisement.
We did, but I misstated that, so we did make a motion to accept that accept the report as presented.
And then we will plan to have that on your agenda on your next meeting. I believe it was your next meeting.
Right. We didn't vote to take action per se. We didn't accept what they gave us.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to clarify.
That's the question. So, do we need to take a vote on this full committee? You'll be, I got you.
Yes.
Thank you. That's Mr. Chairman. I can move.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Walters. No items on the livability. Public Safety and Judiciary, Honorable Michael Brown, Chairman. Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have a few items that came before the committee for our consideration. We did get introduction by Chief Ordinance of our new Poplar Springs Fire Chief. I'm glad that he's in place. I understand it's a smaller occasion that he's back with us. With that, I'll move to our second item. Committee received information to have the courts take desired action in reference to a Violence Against Women Act grant. I move that we approve the submission of the grant application.
I have a motion.
Second.
Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, no vote affirmative, and it passes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Next item, committee received information had reports taken desired action in reference to a 2015 Local Emergency Management Performance Grant. On behalf of the committee, I move that we approve the submission of the grant application.
We have a motion.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, no vote affirmative, and it passes.
Next, Mr. Chairman, we received information and had requests to take desired action in reference to authorizing Commissioner Christopher Aaron Wyatt, Animal Patrol Officer, Spartanburg County Code Enforcement Officer. On behalf of the committee, move that we authorize the commission.
Have a motion?
Second.
Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative, it passes.
Next, Mr. Chairman, we received information, had a request to take desired action in reference to the Greenville County Animal Services Contract. On behalf of the committee, I make a motion that we approve the contract and authorize our county administrator to execute.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative, it passes.
With that, Mr. Chairman, let's open the items that came before the committee.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Under Land Use Committee, I'm chairman, we have an update for our area performance planning presented by Bob Hardricker and Catherine O'Neill. No item requested, no action requested. Public Works Buildings and Grounds, no items. Takes us to item six, public comment period, and we do have some individuals pre-signed to speak. We have Christina Jeffrey to speak, 801 Pound Meadow Street, and we have 3 minutes per speaker. Ms. Jeffrey.
Members of the Spartanburg County Council, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for allowing me to speak to you today. The United States Refugee Resettlement Program serves many purposes, but as it is currently configured, none of these are in the interest of the United States, nor of any individual state, nor of any community. It isn't even in the interest of most refugees who are suffering in United Nations camps around the world. If it were, then the money that is being spent to bring and take care of refugees in the United States would instead be spent in countries that are actually eager to have refugees in their countries, and where the cost of supporting a refugee is about 1/500 what the cost is in the United States. There are people who are actually directly harmed by the United States Refugee Program. The millions of refugees left behind in the camps includes anyone who is killed by a terrorist who comes through the refugee system, which definitely cannot adequately screen, particularly, as we've seen recently, Iraqis, nor can Syrians be screened. On February 11th of this year, before the Homeland Security Committee of the of the Congress, Michael Stenbach, who is the assistant deputy who is in charge of screening refugees, said that Syria is a failed state. You can't screen people from failed states. They will do what they can if the United States insists on bringing refugees, but they cannot ensure our safety or the legitimacy of those refugees. Because if there are no records, if people are fleeing a war zone, they are what they say they are, and you can't find out otherwise. Poor males with low skills who are already losing jobs to younger immigrants will be harmed by increased immigration. Younger immigrants live in large family groups. They are receiving support from the U.S. taxpayers, and they can work for very low wages. American children in schools impacted by large numbers of uneducated non-English speaking children, especially American children who are poor, are in need of special education themselves. And the taxpayers whose children are going to those schools are directly harmed by the overwhelming influx of refugees into certain areas. There's 190 cities that are receiving refugees. And Spartanburg is scheduled to be that 190th city. We, the taxpayers who pay for SSI, used it four times the normal rate.
Ms. Jefferson, we'll give 30 more seconds to wrap it up.
Okay.
Thank you.
What can you do? You can support the efforts of Senator Shane Martin and Lee Bright to include an amendment in the budget to allow you to vote on whether or not refugee resettlement should take place in Spartanburg. And you can listen to the people of the county who deserve to be heard on this important issue. Thank you so much. I have some fact sheets for you.
All right.
U.S. Congress.
He's 32.
Oh, well, maybe not.
He better not.
Maybe he wants to be.
He's already gone through Walter once. He better not be here going through the second time.
And I have a few extras to say.
Next, we have Patty Brown, 128 Sunline.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm a resident of Pierce Acres on the east side, which is within Mr. Britt's district. Lately, I and many other residents of our subdivision have been hearing small caliber gunshots quite frequently in short bursts of 6 to 10 shots throughout the day. I was able to track down the residents that the shots were coming from and call to have a deputy come out and address the problem. It is such a definite safety issue. I was informed by the responding deputy that there is no law, statewide or through county ordinance, prohibiting the discharge of a weapon anywhere within the boundaries of the county, excepting for a provision involving hunting. My husband and I were flabbergasted by this. It is inherently dangerous to fire a gun in such close proximity to another residence. A stray bullet can kill and a ricochet can end up anywhere. Even if someone is firing into the ground, a bullet can hit a rock or root and fly around uncontrollably. This means it could hit a house, a moving vehicle, or God forbid, a person. There are many children that live within and play within this neighborhood, and what a tragedy it would be if a child were killed because of the willful negligence of the shooter and the unwillingness of any legislative body to address the circumstances in which it is permissible to discharge a firearm. We don't need to wait for a state bill that is named for a dead child. I'm not asking to infringe upon anyone's Second Amendment rights. I am a supporter of that amendment. However, it only guarantees an individual's right to keep and bear those arms. It does not grant the right to discharge a weapon recklessly. My husband and I are both former law enforcement officers. We have several guns in our home. I myself have a CWP. We would never consider firing any weapon in such close proximity to another person's property. It is incredibly irresponsible to do so, and anyone with common sense would know that. Unfortunately, there are people that either don't have that or just don't care. As a police officer, I had a 12-year-old boy die at my feet as we worked to save him. He died because of a stray bullet. I know what the consequences can be, and because of this, I am proposing that council consider drafting an ordinance prohibiting the discharge of a weapon within 300 yards of a dwelling or business. This is a safety issue, not a Second Amendment issue. No one is attempting to circumvent that amendment, but just to legislate a restriction upon where a gun can be fired. There's a lot of support within the confines of our neighborhood for some type of action to be taken. This does not only affect our subdivision, but anyone that lives within this county boundaries. The city of Spartanburg has an ordinance prohibiting the discharge of a firearm. I have to suppose that this is because it's a densely populated area. So are subdivisions. Just because I can drive a vehicle 70 miles an hour down a residential street, that doesn't mean that I should, and the state agrees by posting a speed limit. This is because it would be dangerous and irresponsible, much the same as firing a gun next to another person's home. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Next we have Jason Lee, 622 Alamo Street.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and County Council. Appreciate the service you do to our county. I just wanted to speak a minute in terms of the refugee resettlement. As one who's been serving in Spartanburg almost 6 years, we found it to be, my family and I originally from the state of Georgia, a welcoming community and county. Spartanburg is second most, the highest county for worm population in the state, as well as the first in actually foreign-owned businesses in the state of South Carolina. And we're excited about the potential for the refugee resettlement. Studies have been showing how this is a positive impact to the community. Cleveland did a study that covered 12 years of refugee resettlement, over 4,500 refugees that were resettled there, where it showed that after 2 years, only 8% of those refugees were still in government services of any kind. And part of that is because you have refugees fleeing from some of those horrendous suffering that we're forced in this country we've hardly ever had to experience, except for maybe one day, that fateful day on 9/11. And so this program is one that has been honored and has been implemented for years by our presidents and through the U.S. State Department through our state. And so traditionally this hasn't been a county council issue, just like you don't deal with any other immigration issues if a person is seeking immigration. And so I want to be happy to share the facts and how this program started. And we actually have no Iraqi or Syrians in process to be resettled as refugees in this program. And I think one thing that there's a lot of confusion about is the State Department approved Spartanburg County to have a refugee resettlement affiliate office. It doesn't mean all the refugees will be here. There actually is a 100-mile radius that they can be resettled in. And that's why traditionally Spartanburg has resettled refugees that have actually from Lutheran services in Colombia, as we've resettled Laotian, Cambodian, as well as Ukrainian refugees over the years, and that came out of that Colombia office. And as many of you may know, some of those refugees that have been resettled. We have a long history of that in our county. We have 9 Ukrainian churches that are evidence of those resettlement efforts. And then there's a number of businessmen. You can go right up the street to Kapasi Glass. Hassan Kapasi was a refugee that came here and built a life for his family and provided jobs and positive economic impact for this city and for this county. And I could share more stories. I know the time is short, but we'd be open to any dialogue with the county councilman to tell you more about it. But at the end of the day, this tradition has been a federal program that happened through the state, which is why our governor endorsed it on April 21st publicly, and then with a letter of support from the state DSS office last July. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cleese. And next we have Jim Goodrow, 394 Old South Road.
I moved here 15 years ago as director of missions with Spartanburg County Baptist Network, an association of now 100 churches. I wanted to just overview the timeline of the movement that has resulted in refugee scheduled to come here. In 2009, I began working with the Spartanburg Convention and the Visitors Bureau to bring to Spartanburg the National Ethnic Ministry Summit. This event has been an annual event since 2000, sponsored by the Billy Graham Center, which is always operated out of the Ethnic American Network, and Billy Graham Center at Wichita College. We were able to bring in 2012 to Spartanburg the Ethnic Ministry Summit, which took place in Evangel Cathedral. To this day, we're the only non-mega city ever to host that event. We had 70 seminars at that event. About a year later, one of the seminar speakers, Matthew Sorens from World Relief, came and I facilitated and pastors and Christian leaders immigration awareness briefing and luncheon at First Baptist North Spartanburg. Had about 70 persons to attend that event. In the introduction, he shared that World Relief is a corporation of the National Association of Evangelicals, best known for relief ministry around the world. But in the U.S., it mobilizes the American church's mission to immigrants and refugees through 23 offices around the U.S., but none in South Carolina. At the lunch break and after the meeting, he was swamped by people there who said, you ought to be in South Carolina, it should be in Spartanburg. So as the one who facilitated that meeting, I sort of became the spokesman for the effort that has since resulted in refugees coming here. It had to be approved by our state government. Also happy to be recommended by World Relief. Those two agencies did a demographic study of the Spartanburg area, submitted the proposal to the U.S. State Department, which was approved. In August of last year, I facilitated a meeting that was primary for partner churches. Four World Relief executives were here for 2 days visiting the city. I facilitated a meeting of prospective partner churches. 54 persons came to that event. Convention and Visitors Bureau was represented at that meeting. Congressman Trey Gaddis' office was represented at that meeting. This had almost 70 people attending the first training session for good neighbor teams from churches that will help resettle the refugees here. And so this is an effort of church people wanting to extend the love and compassion of Jesus Christ. Half the people in the refugee system worldwide are persecuted Christians who've had to flee their country. The other half are not Christians. They may never have heard about Jesus. So this is a movement of local churches wanting to minister the love and compassion of Jesus Christ, taking individual responsibility to help process and assimilate each family who comes. Thank you.
Thank you. Alexa Newman here tonight. Now, normally council does not speak during public comment period, but I'm going to state the county's position at this time. In recent months, well-meaning members of this community on both sides of the refugee issue have voiced strong positions. As a body, county council is always concerned when its citizens are polarized, but this is a very complex legal and regulatory matter with no county council involvement, regardless of what is in the Senate proviso, which is wrong and should be stricken immediately. Congressman Trey Gowdy has taken the lead in gathering information about this project. Because Congressman Gowdy has been spearheading the information gathering effort, county council is waiting for his office to render his findings on this matter. As a community and as a council, it would be premature and potentially damaging to our community, as well as to potentially defamatory and slanderous to those involved, to rush to judgment before all of Congressman Gowdy inquiry is complete. So I urge patience and restraint until the time when more information is available. That's the county's position. Thank you. That closes public comment period. Now we'll go to old business. Item A, render second reading to an ordinance to amend Chapter 2, Article 5, Division 2 of the Spartanburg County Code of Ordinances relative to Spartanburg County Alcohol and Drug Abuse Commission to provide for a change in the name of the commission, which better encompasses all elements of services and treatment provided to the residents of Spartanburg County.
So move.
Have a motion. Second, Jane. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, a vote affirmative, and passed. Item B, render second reading to an ordinance to develop a joint county industrial park in conjunction with Cherokee County, South Carolina, to be geographically located in Spartanburg County, South Carolina, and established pursuant to the South Carolina Code of Laws, 1976, a park with Cherokee County in agreement with the city of Spartanburg and for matters related there.
Mr. Chairman, I move to postpone the second reading to the next regular or special council.
I have a motion to postpone.
I'll second.
Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, a vote affirmative, and it passes. Item C, render second reading to the budget ordinance related to the fiscal affairs of Spartanburg County, making appropriations, therefore, levy and taxes for fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2015, and ending June 30, 2016, to provide for budget control of said appropriation by county council.
Move we approve.
Have a motion.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
I would like to express my thanks to staff for all the assistance that they have given me. I still am trying to work my way through this notebook of budget items, and I find it a little overwhelming to this old country boy that's getting age on him, so he doesn't remember as much as he used to. But I do have a couple of things I want to clarify, Mr. O'Neill, if I can.
I guess you want me to address them to you, right? Would that be the best thing to do?
Certainly.
Share with me, we've talked a lot in the last year about the local government fund. This budget, from what I understand, does not include any increases over what we had last year.
That's correct, Councilman Waller. It's our understanding that there is no allocation of additional resources in the current version of the budget in this end of the House.
All right, essentially, and I don't ask for exact numbers, but what are, if we calculate it the way we've been calculating, we're short?
About $4 million a year.
All right, and if I remember correctly, and all the information you gave us, that we're about $5 million short of what we really needed. You had to take the request and pull it down to 89 million, but from 95 or so, right?
Okay, we're probably closer to the 5.7, 6 million.
Right.
In that neighborhood.
So, but we've got we could take care of that the needs that we have in Spartanburg County significantly if we had our local government.
Yes, sir. We were very close to a balanced budget with the revenues had the local government fund been fully funded.
Right.
It would not have been exactly what we were closer.
Now, share with me, if you would, in the, here again, I'm trying to learn the line items the way we've got them. I'm using your general overview instead of trying to go to each individual page. I'm looking on the expenditures for a magistrate court, and it shows $2.8 million. Where do we get the revenues to cover that expenditure?
Sure, well, Councilman Walker, the total expenditures are not covered by revenues. So the magistrate court does collect fines and other fees that come in through the court system. A large percentage of that, half or more, is turned over to the state as part of the county's responsibility to provide what they see as their portion of those revenues. So what remains has the county anywhere from $1 million to $1.5 million short of what the actual expenses are to run the department.
So basically, we're asked to fund this court. The monies that we get from fines and so forth, half of it state won't take it, which won't give us our government local funds. So we're giving them money instead of us giving money where we should be getting.
Sure, I would imagine that in a number of cases, the state tries to assign the appropriate fines to make the court whole. But in this case, we're sharing those fines with the state. The council has never taken, that I'm aware, has never taken the position that a court has to be a balanced budget where they are required to bring in enough revenue to cover their costs. The idea behind the local government fund was for the state to provide the funds to pay for their expenses, and in this case, it would be court operations.
And I don't want to ask you a question that we may not have fully information on, but do you have a feel for throughout the state how many of the courts are pretty well generating enough income from the fines to pay for their cost, or do we know that?
Sure, I can't speak to all other 45 counties, but I do work closely with the county administrators in the larger counties. Of course, I came from a county that's considered to be one of the larger ones myself. While I was in Lexington County, I can share with you that the court system did not generate enough money to pay for their expenses, with just the revenues that remain with the county, same to our situation. In talking with the county administrators over the last year, I'm not aware of any county where the court revenue that remains with the county covers the expenses. All of the counties are short of both sides of the funds, largely in court operations.
All right. In the,
Bob, I hate to interrupt you, but I mean, this stuff really should be dealt with the administrator. You got a lot of people want to talk about, you know, some issues they can't sit for. We've been through this. I mean, I've spent my time, a couple hours with Catherine. You know, again, with respect to people out here waiting to hear about two or three, you know, key issues for them.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir, Mr. Walker.
Are are we not entitled?
Sure you are, Mr. Portman.
So does, just because one councilman doesn't like what I'm...
Well, I don't mind what you're saying, I'm just trying to, 644, people have been waiting for a long time.
So which is more important, time or this budget?
Well, for me, people out in the audience, I trust that I've got sufficient knowledge. I don't need to hear all your questions about the budget. I mean, I think that's something, if you want to meet with the staff, do it, you know, but don't take up the people in the audience's time. That's not the point, you know. It's like when I get on a plane, fly Delta, I don't ask the pilot to tell me how this thing's going to work, just get me there. If I want to sit down with him, I can talk to him a little later when I'm not holding up 200 people.
All right, Mr. Walker, any additional questions for the...
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Ms. O'Neill, I want to ask you, trying to determine the, this happened, you know, this is covered prior to me coming here, is the insurance fund. I look under expenditures and I see a line item, and I also see a line item over under revenue for insurance fund. Are we, I guess the insurance fund itself is covered out of the general fund, and then we pay for it, but we put it into an insurance fund?
Sure, I believe that you're talking about the health insurance fund, is that
right? Right, yes, yes, ma'am, I'm sorry.
So, all of the departments have employees, and if those employees are, well, I would say almost all of our departments and funds have employees, and almost all of them have employees who are eligible for health insurance. So each one of those, be the general fund or any of the other funds that make up $177 million for the entire budget, they each contribute a set amount to our insurance fund. And then from that fund, we pay for a variety of expenses, as you see there. The largest one, of course, is our contribution to the Public Employee Benefits Association, the State Health Insurance Fund.
All right. In that fund, based on our funding process and this year, I can say that there is no part-time employees in funding under these accounts.
So the insurance, the eligibility for health insurance in Spartanburg County is if an employee is scheduled to regularly work 30 hours or more per week. So technically, someone would be considered part-time if they're not working full schedule. But the eligibility threshold for health insurance is scheduled to work 30 hours per week.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're welcome, Mr. Paul. Other questions, comments?
We're going to see.
Yeah. Item C, David.
Yes, sir. That's right.
We have a motion. Second. We have two motion, two second.
I'll second.
Okay, good. All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed. I vote affirmative. It passes. Thank you. Item D, render second reading to a budget ordinance to establish capital project budgets for 2015-26 budget year for a 5-year capital improvement plan.
Move to approve second reading.
Have a motion.
Second.
Any other discussion?
Mr. Chairman, this can be given here by Mr. Brett.
what are you going to
do about it? We have minutes from our special meeting on May the 4th, whatever.
Yes, sir, they were inflated in your calendar.
I did not get that either. Can I ask a question?
Sure, y'all know I got to go speak somewhere later.
I know.
Does this, and maybe that's what Roger's looking at, what is the amount in this, did we not vote to make a change in the amount that was in the original ordinance for the capital projects to this, what we'll have tonight? Did we not vote to move it from $3 to $5?
I believe that the question that you're asking has to do with the fee revenue.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so at your budget workshop, you had talked about the adjustment of the fee for our household user fee. And yes, that was incorporated.
I thought we voted, the vote was to raise it to $5.
And that was incorporated into the information that you received for second reading.
Yeah, we just had a second.
We amended it and added it in, and so it's in the second reading.
It's in the second reading.
Yes, sir.
I have no further questions, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. All right, we have a motion and a second. Any other questions or comments? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, a vote affirmative, it passes. Item eight, consider an application for a special public event exclusion for the noise ordinance requested by Greg Ragway from 4 p.m. until midnight on Saturday, June 13, 2015, and Saturday, June 27, 2015, for a drag race at 1792 Dragway Road Rear.
Move we approve.
Motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, a vote affirmative, it passes. Item B, consider an application for a special public event exclusion from the noise ordinance requested by Bowling Springs Ale House from 7 p.m. until 10 p.m. on Thursday, June 11, 2015, and from 3 p.m. until 8 p.m. on Saturday, June 20, 2015, for live music outside of 2220 Bowling Springs Road, Bowling Springs.
One more, Mr. Chairman. Can we, do we have to vote on these together, or can we vote on them separately?
What do you mean?
I don't know.
Oh, you're talking about tonight, the times. I don't know, what do you say, Catherine, all yours?
You moved to divide the question, can't you?
We can do them separately. It would just be a motion, and whatever, however we should take on the question. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. All right, we do have a motion.
Do we have a motion?
We do. Do we, somebody made a motion?
No, I didn't.
No one made a motion?
I moved.
No one made a motion.
I moved.
Bob made a motion, does it proceed?
Proceed.
Okay. Don't make a curve tonight. Do we have a second?
We have a second.
Do we have a second?
I'll second.
We got a second. We pulling teams up here. All right, any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? Wait a minute, back up. All in favor, raise your hand, well, I vote last, I'm sorry. All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote in favor. You fail? I didn't see. You fail, maybe?
Fail.
Thank you. Good to see you, Mom. Item nine, reading and approval of resolutions, ordinances, agreements, petitions, and other documents, and other industrial facilities through issuance of Spartanburg County industrial development and similar lines and legal agreements. Enough. Any other, how about the BAR, B-A-R resolutions?
Yes, sir. There are a number of budget amendment resolutions before this relatively short list, but we'll have answering questions about them. At least one of them came from the community this afternoon.
All righty. Any motion on the BAR?
So moved.
Yes, sir. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, or affirmative, it passes.
Ms. Lane's Council Matters, I've got one item.
Yeah, oh, you're 10. Miscellaneous Council Matters and Budget Amendments.
Okay, good. This is referring to Mrs. Brown's presentation on the problem of shooting in densely populated areas. This isn't the first time a council member, even me, have heard this complaint. I've had issues now in Pine Acres, which is right off Fernwood Glendale Road, 4 Mile Branch Road in my council district, and now Pierce Acres. And this is really, in the last year, it's got to be a bigger and bigger problem. Out of the 6 council districts, 4 council districts have had problems as well. Up in the Lyman area, there was a house that was shot into by some people out just target shooting and playing around, weren't being safe. Fortunately, no one was killed. Rogers area's had issues. James area's has had issues. We have wrestled with this thing. I know I've wrestled with it along with the chairman. Jeff has been a great help trying to come to some type of resolution and solution to it. Our staff, we've had meetings with our administrator, our lawyers. We've met with the sheriff, people from the sheriff's department,
you can ask a person who is formerly with the NRA, who lives in Spartanburg County, to take a look at the situation. And she was appalled at what was going on in a couple of subdivisions. I talked with Kibby Krill, there's Kibby right there, last week about it. And Kibby, I think, had a great idea. I mean, we've tried to come to grips with its distance, whatever. And like Ms. Brown, you said, it's a very small number of people that do dumb things, but it only takes one to kill a child. I mean, unfortunately, you saw a 12-year-old die at your footstep, or at your feet, or an adult, or someone gets seriously wounded. You can't put those people back together again. We're not talking about infringing on gun ownership, anything like that, just responsible gun use. Kibby's idea, I thought, was fantastic, to form a citizens advisory committee made up of a small number of people, maybe representing the six council districts, get six citizens, and then get some ad hoc members. I've talked with Representative Eddie Town. Eddie said he would serve as an ad hoc member. I think Representative Rita Allison will. We can ask Senator Shane Martin, because Shane's had some contacts. I think I know you all may have contacted Shane. Others have on other occasions, but to form some type of citizens advisory committee with some ad hoc members, and even have a couple council members on it. So that's what I'd like to ask the chairman if he would do to take this under consideration, form a committee, and I'd love to have Kibby involved in. He served on a committee that we did similarly with the sheriff and
Bill Chumley,
doing some education at the jail.
Bill Chumley.
Yep, George Summon. And I think that thing turned out great. So, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to ask you if you would take it under consideration, if you can form a citizen advisory committee to work on this, report back to council on some moves and some recommendations for some type of ordinance or resolution, and also have someone from the Sheriff's Department involved, and possibly even the solicitor's office.
Right. Anything else? Item 11, approval of minutes, April 20, 2015, May 4, 2015.
So moved.
Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative. Passes. Thank you for your attendance tonight. Be careful. Any motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second. Get out of the
way. You're
folding. Folding.